translation by Alan Mandelbaum. So let's begin. Book 2, page 21. Book 2, Dawn. Public appeal in vain. Telemachus before the altars of Ithaca. His complaint against the suitors. The omen of the eagles. An augur's prediction of Odysseus' return and his vengeance of the suitors. First light. Dawn's rose fingers touch the sky. The dear son of Odysseus. Quick to rise and dress, since set within his shoulder strap, the sharpest blade, to his feet anointed, sleek, he tied fine sandals as he crossed the threshold. He seemed a god. At once he told his heralds with voices clear to call a council. The long-haired Ithacans were soon assembled. Then he, his lance of bronze held fast, advanced, but not alone. Behind two brisk hounds paced, on him Athena shed a deathless grace, and all the people marveled as he came. To the assembly ground, he took his place, his father's seat, to elders all give way. The first to speak was Lord Aegyptius. One bent with age, astute in all life's ways. The spearman Antiphas was his dear son, the good Odysseus' close companion. One had sailed in hollow ships to Ilion, where many fine foals grace. But in the cave of brutal Cyclops, when that savage ate the Ithacans, his final meal was made of Antiphas. Three other sons were born of Lord Aegyptius, and although one, Eurynomus, had joined the suitors' band, the last two formed their aged father's land, and yet Aegyptius did not forget his absent son. His grief was long and deep. Now, even as he wept, he urged the chiefs to listen, Ithacans, to what I say. This is our assembly, since the day when hollow ships bore bright dishes away. But who is he who summons us? We needed to see a scholar here, a younger man, or one well on in years. Did he hear a word of an approaching force? Want to share the first alert with us, or did he need to rally this assembly for other public matters he'll discuss? In any case, he seems to be courageous, blessed by the gods. May Zeus be generous, and let this man fulfill with his heart beals. His words were done, and Zeus's dear son delighted in the presence she had heard. Sad no longer, but prepared to speak, he stood among the Ithacans. Pasinor, the herald wise in council, set the scepter to his hand, and then Telemachus spoke words meant chiefly for Aegyptius. Old man, as he yourself was sent to hear, the one who called his council is at hand. I am the man who wanted us to meet, the man who more than any Hermes grief. I have no news of an invading fleet, an urgent warning I must now repeat to every Ithacan, nor would I speak of other public things. All that I plead is my own sorry case. A double curse has fallen my house, for I have lost most courageous father, he who once ruled, you who gather here, a man most gentle, and still another evil threatens me. The ruin of my house will be complete. All that we own will be consumed. The suitors and dear son of those who are the most noblest here against her will besiege my mother now. They are afraid to seek my father's house, though it's a Icarius who should endow his daughter with a dowry, then bestow her hand upon the man he favors most. Instead, they crowd into our house. They slaughter oxen and rams and fat goats. There, they guzzle our glowing wine, their stupid rite. They revel. They waste our wealth away. There's no defense to no man who, as a dish is good, might end this pestilence. I am too weak to check their insolence. Yes, even if I tried, I lack warcraft, the power, the device. Had I the force, I certainly would fight. Their acts are unterrible. My house had gone to ruin, a disastrous course. You too should scorn their ways and feel the force of shame for what your neighbors here have wrought. Beware, the gods grown angry for these acts of malice may assault you in their wrath. I call upon Olympian Zeus and Themis. She disperses and convenes men's meetings. My friends, let each of you go his own way. Leave me to my despair. Or can it be the brave Odysseus? He brought injury to the Achaeans with their sturdy griefs. You, revenging that, would harass me, inciting those who court Penelope. If that is so, it would indeed be better were you and not the suitors to consume my herds and treasures. Then I could at least receive fair recompense. We would persist, would press our claim throughout the town, insist on payment for our goods, until the worth was given back in full. But now, you cast despair into my heart, a sorrow past all care and cure. These were his bitter words, throwing his scepter to the ground. He wept, and pity overcame the people. All the rest were motionless, and no one dared to answer him with harsh words, none except the Antinous, who in replying said, Telemachus, with roaring words unchecked, your anger blames defamous us, but be sure, if anyone's to blame, it's not the suitors, but the supreme deceiver, your dear mother. 3 years have passed, the fort will be gone soon. She still continues to connive, to thwart the hands of the Achaeans. She would support. She offers every suitor hope and promise. Meanwhile, her mind is bent in something else. Her heart defies this guile. Within her room, Penelope set up his spacious loom. The web was wide, the threads were fine, and she assured us all unhesitatingly. Young man, since bride Odysseus is now dead, be patient, though you're keen to marry me. Wait till the cloth is done, lest any threat, and raffle, this is lordly artisan shroud. The robe he'll wear when dark death strikes him down. I weave it now, lest some Achaean women contempt me for neglect, for having let the man who'd won such wealth lie at his death without a shroud. These were her words, and we with manly hearts agreed. So she would weave that might web by day, but then by night, by torchlight, she indeed what she had done. She had queen to Olafus for 3 long years. But when the spring returned, the fourth was here. One of her women servants, well aware of how her mother had connived, told all. We caught Penelope, she unraveled the lovely web. So she against her will completed it. This is our just return to you, that you may know that in your heart, and the Achaeans all may know it too. Send off your mother now, and order her to wed the suitor chosen by your father, and pleasing to herself. And should she vex the sons of the Achaeans any longer, should she consider nothing but the gifts Athena gave to her, and I admit no woman can serve best her handiwork, discerning mind and subtle craftiness, not even those of ancient days could match your mother. Even the Achaean women wear their thick dresses in the distant past. My scene of the lovely crown, Alcmene and Tyro, none has ever had her wits. Then will her calculations be this once mistaken, for as long as she intends to keep the stubborn counsel that some god has planted in her heart, so long shall we consume your goods, your wealth, that may bring glory to her, but it means poverty to you. Be sure of this. We will not tend our fields or leave your halls until your mother shall have chosen one of us and married him. Telemachus' reply was thoughtful, wise, and tenuous. There's no way in which I can expel against her will. The one who gave me life, who raised me, not my father, alive or dead, is elsewhere on this earth. And should I choose to send my mother off, then I alone would bear the bitter cost of having to repay Icarius the price of all her terror brought to us. So I would suffer at her father's hand. To those suffering, the gods would add still others, for my mother, as she left this house, would call upon the dread avengers. Men too would blame me. Thus I never shall send off my mother. But if you can feel remorse within your heart, then leave my halls. Just hold your future revels someplace else. Consume your own fine goods, and let each for each prepare in turn in his own house a feast. And that ends the first part of the book 2 of the Odyssey of Homer. I hope you all enjoyed listening, and see you again soon.